We've been going to the English church in Benidorm for about 30 years, 30 years next December. It's our local church. It's a, very similar to this. They preach the word of life. It's a full gospel church. The Lord Jesus is the center of the ministry.
Amen.
That's the most important thing. Because if he's not center, then what's the point in coming?
Yeah.
Because the Bible says in Colossians that in all things he should have the preeminence.
Mm.
Not in some things, all things. So that's in the Sunday school, in the Bible study, in the prayer meeting, in the services, in the sermon. The Lord Jesus is the center. What I was given a few minutes ago, I only ever try to bring the word of God. There's two or three things because of the circumstances in Gaza and the situation in the Middle East. The people are not aware and you wonder what on earth is going to happen next. Basically, what I want to say to you, and you can look up the scriptures yourself, it's all in here in the Word of God. I'll give you the scriptures and everything. But right throughout the New Testament, in many, many times, Paul and other gospel writers and apostles, when they wrote, they started off by saying, I don't want you to be ignorant. I would not have you to be ignorant. And it's so easy to go through life and be ignorant of certain things that we've either not been told, or when we've read them, it hasn't hit us. But the Lord's saying all the time, I don't want you to be ignorant. And one of these cases is in Matthew 24. Some of the disciples sat the Lord Jesus down on the Mount of Olives just before he ascended. And they said to him, Lord, not all the disciples were there, only a certain number, four or five, I think. And he sat down and they asked him point blank, what will it be like just before you return on the earth? They asked him plainly, a plain question. And he didn't sidestep them and try and give them some, fob them off with some other answer. He told them straight exactly what it's going to be like. He said it would be exactly like the days of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be exactly like the days before the flood.
Mm-hmm.
And he gave many, many examples right through Matthew 24, Luke 21, and the other Gospels. Many, many signs of his coming. But only two examples, as it was in the days of Noah and as it was in the days of Lot in Sodom. Those are the only two examples. And they said they didn't know until the flood came and took them all away. There was no warning. And the same in Sodom and Gomorrah. The two angels went in the night before into Sodom to warn Lot and his family to get out. It's amazing because Lot was backslidden. He's away from the Lord. But imagine the mercy of the Lord. He sent the two angels. They weren't dressed as angels. This is in Genesis chapter 19. You read the story. They went in there the night before to get Lot and his family out, because the Lord was going to rain fire and brimstone onto the cities of the plain. Sodom and Gomorrah and some other cities. But what I said about not being ignorant, Jesus says in Matthew 24 and also in Luke 21, learn the parable of the fig tree. I want you to learn it. And you think, well, what is a fig tree? Now, Israel in the Old Testament is often referred to as the old olive tree, but he also refers to it as the fig tree. And Jesus says, Luke 21, this is in Luke 21, 29, there's a better rendering in Matthew 24, it's a bit more detail. And Jesus spoke to them, Luke 21, 29, then Jesus spoke to them, said a parable, look at the fig tree, look at Israel, in other words, Yes, the other trees as well, but particularly look at Israel, what's happening there. And he said to them, and when they're already budding, you see and know for yourselves that summer is near. So also, when you see these things happening, know that the kingdom of God is near. Assuredly, that means absolute certainty, I say to you, this generation will by no means pass away till all things take place. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Now what he's saying is, and I've heard so many people over the years who got confused, and the word generation throws them. And they say, how long is a generation? Is it 40 years? Is it 60 years? Is it 120 years it was in the days of Noah? How long is a generation? Jesus is not talking about how long a generation is. That's not what he's saying. If you read it carefully, what he's saying is, this generation will by no means pass away till all things have taken place. Israel was reborn in 1948, May the 14th. For 400 years they were under Turkey. In Jesus' time it was under the Romans. Britain looked after it from 1917 to 1948. And the Star of David was raised on May the 14th at midnight. The British Union Jack was taken down and the Star of David was raised at May the 14th at midnight. And Israel became a nation for the first time in over 2,000 years. Some say it was about 2,011 years. Because they were under the Romans in Jesus' time, but they were completely independent in May 14th, 1948. What Jesus is saying here, not how long is a generation, but he's saying the generation that sees this will by no means pass away. He didn't say that some of them wouldn't have died, but the entire generation that sees that happen in 1948 will by no means have passed away till all things be fulfilled. So that's just to clear up one little point so you don't get confused about generations and times, because he's not talking about that. So Israel's about 75 years old, 77 years, something like that, since it's been a nation independent. What's going on there? But Jesus said, watch, because that is a sign that summer is at the door and my coming is at the door. When you see these things, Russia may come down, China, North Korea, Iran. And can I tell you something from the Word of God? They will be decimated. They haven't got a chance. Israel's only the size of Wales, size of New Jersey for the Americans. Tiny little country. Russia with 11 time zones, two or three times the size of the United States. And Israel, size of Wales. But Jesus is King of the Jews.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. But he's not lost his King of the Jews title, and he always will be. And he's not going to abandon his people. So whatever we think of them and what our opinions are and what's going on, and we've all got different opinions, but he's going to come and save his people. And if China knew and Russia knew and a few of these other merchants, if they knew when they come down what would be the end, they wouldn't go near. Can I tell you, because don't forget the God of Israel. He's our God. He's the God of the Bible. He said there aren't any other gods, only me. And it's the people that have sinned against him, they've turned to other gods, they've done all kinds of terrible things. And we've done things in our lives that we're ashamed of. And he's been merciful and gracious to us. And the same will be, he will not forget or abandon his people. And so that was that one thing. He said, learn that parable. The other verse that he gave me was also in Luke 21, verse 36. Because in the book of Revelation, Matthew 24, Luke 21, and in other chapters, it says about the things that are coming on the earth. He said it will be so awful, Jesus said in Matthew 24, that it will be, there'd be never been a time in history like it ever before, and there never will be again as long as the earth remains. It will be so terrible. And Jesus is going to unleash his wrath, the wrath of the Lamb, on the nations of the world. You read it yourself in the book of Revelation. He's a God of love and mercy and everything, but the limit is come. The wine cup of fury is near at the top, ready to pour over, because he's had enough of it. We know the Lord's Prayer. He taught us to say that prayer, but he also taught us to say another prayer. And it's in Luke 21, verse 36. Jesus said, "Watch therefore and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." I try to say that prayer most days if I can. Some days I forget, but most days I try and say it. I hope and pray I will be caught up in the rapture to escape all these things. Yeah. But Jesus said to pray it anyway, and to ask that we will escape it. So it is a prayer similar to the Lord's Prayer, Luke 21, verse 36. To pray always. And the last verse that he gave me is from the book of Revelation, chapter 19. Anyway, I've got it here somewhere. I can quote it to you anyway. It's in Revelation 19. And it's, the Lord says, "The marriage supper of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready." Now, we've been taught through scriptures for years and years, and through Bibles and churches and whatever, the Holy Spirit changes us gradually inside.
Verse 7, 19:7,
yeah. And this is absolutely true. The Holy Spirit changes us from day to day, different things, shows us things where we need to change, whatever. But this is so important. There are other verses in scripture. The Lord is saying that his wife, his bride, has made herself ready. So the Holy Spirit is changing us gradually, but also he's saying to us, as you can see what's going on around in the world, that we need to have an opportunity to prepare ourselves for his coming, and to make sure we have our wedding garments on, and that we're fit for his coming. And in New Testament times, the bride used to take sometimes a year, 18 months, while the bridegroom went away, preparing herself for the coming. She didn't know that the father used to send the son to get his bride, and she never knew. But all she had to do was to make sure she was ready and prepared and beautiful, and her wedding garments were clean and pure. All these things I'm saying to you, I'm saying to myself,
yeah,
because they apply to me more than anyone. I heard a mighty man of God, an evangelist you would all know, and he said these words, I'll never forget it. "Don't imagine that the Lord Jesus is going to come for a bride with a wedding garment, with a wedding dress on, that's covered in cigarette burns and wine stains." And that, I heard that 35, 40 years ago, and it really stuck with me. And it's so easy to be led astray by these things. So the Holy Spirit changes us, he prepares us, he points out areas, people we need to forgive. But the same with the bride and the wife, she's made herself ready. So the Lord's doing his part, but he's expecting the wife and the church to do her part. And the problem is, the alternative is being left behind in the rapture.
Yes, yeah.
And then going through the tribulation. That's why Jesus said, pray the prayer that you be counted worthy to escape all these things and stand before the Son of Man. And I do try and pray that daily. I hope that's a help to everyone.